Greetings, everyone, and welcome to our Arts Justice Town Hall for the Bay Area. Folks are still joining us. My name is Amir Whitaker. I'm a policy attorney here in Southern California, actually, but with the ACLU, but we work statewide. So it's an honor to be here with you all today. Maybe pass it to Sonia. Sonia, you want to introduce yourself as well?
Sure. Hi, everyone. It's so nice to be here. My name is Sonia Banker. I am a senior in high school in the San Francisco Bay Area. And currently I work as an Arts Justice Fellow with Amir at the ACLU, doing some arts education advocacy work. I will pass it off to Natalie.
Everyone, I'm Natalie Steingard. I am from the Los Angeles area and I'm a senior in high school. I am the Arts Justice Fellow at the ACLU. And I'm gonna pass it off to Caitlin.
Hey there, I'm Caitlin Lena, pronouns she, her. I'm the Youth Engagement Manager for CREATE California. And I'll pass it off to Sam.
Hi, everyone. My name is Sam Bass. So happy to be here. I am the director of the Arts Department for San Francisco Unified School District. And I will pass it to Sophia.
Hi, everybody. Welcome. My name is Sophia Fojas. I'm the arts coordinator for the Santa Clara County Office of Education. And I will pass it on to, Sophie, did you go yet?
I did not. Hi, everyone. It's so lovely to be here with you all. My name is Sophie Sila. I use she, her pronouns, and I'm a legal fellow with the ACLU of Southern California on the education equity team, and I'm a former educator and art teacher. And I'm not sure if that's everyone. Are we missing anyone?
Pass it to Miko.
Oh, apologies, Miko.
That's okay. Hi, everyone. I'm Miko Lee from Teaching Artists Guild. So happy to be here with you all.
Great, thanks for that, Miko, and thank you for all of our partners and panelists from joining us from all over the Bay Area. It's an honor to be here and share space with you all today. I'm gonna pass it back to Sonia to walk us through our land acknowledgement.
Sure, now that we've all introduced ourselves, I thought it would be really nice because we are all from different parts of California to go around and just acknowledge the land that we are each on today. So I live in San Francisco, I'm on Ohlone land, and I would love to just acknowledge the fact that I'm here and that I'm taking space on this land. So I'll pass it off to Natalie to just share what land you're on and acknowledging that.
Sorry, my computer froze. Hi, I'm Natalie, I said that before, and I'm on Islam land. And should I pass it off to someone else?
No, that's fine for now, Natalie, but we encourage everyone to either drop in the chat which land you're on, acknowledging the land. If you'd like to unmute and say it, you can do that as well. I'm also down here in Los Angeles on Tonga and Chumash land. And we've included the link there, www.native-land.ca for you to see which native and ancestral land you're on. And we acknowledge that the original peoples of these lands, their dynamic cultures and their resilience are an important part of the history of this state. We acknowledge that their cultural teachings are necessary for the ongoing efforts to protect air, water, and land. Would anyone else like to share which land they're on? And thank you, Miko, for sharing earlier. All right, thank you all. So now we're gonna share a video of the Arts Justice Council, and Sonia, you wanna share what this video is about?
Sure, so a lot of the student work we are attempting to do is statewide. And so it's really about understanding arts inequities across California. And so last year I founded a coalition of students called the ACLU Arts Justice Council. And we tackle issues surrounding arts education, arts advocacy around California. We speak at conferences and other events. We host events and then we put on an edition or a journal of student artwork every 3 months. So that project allows students to collaborate, to bring art to students surrounding a social justice theme, which we'll get to a bit later. But this video kind of showcases the students that we've worked with and kind of what our mission is. So I hope you enjoy.
Hi, my name is Sonia. I'm a junior in high school, and I'm from San Francisco, California.
Hi, I'm Rachel. I'm in ninth grade, and I'm from Irvine, California.
Hi, my name is Jessica Norris. I am a senior in high school, and I live in Santa Cruz, California.
My name is Monica Wilson. I'm a senior in high school. I live in Sonoma, California.
Hello, my name is Kate De La Torre. I am a senior in high school, and I live in Los Angeles, California.
Hi, my name is Nicolette Huang, and I live in San Diego, California, and I'm currently in 8th grade.
The Arts Justice Council is a coalition of 10 students that works in affiliation with the ACLU Southern California's Youth Liberty Squad. We specifically combat this statistic of 9 out of every 10 schools lacking arts education. And in our work, we collaborate with other organizations, we work with the Road to Find, and we also work with the ACLU of Southern California and legislative change to actually ensure that there is a holistic arts education in school districts.
One of the reasons that I joined the AJC was that I thought it was a great way to stay creatively active, and I also thought it was really cool that I can stay informed about things that are going on in my community.
I joined the AJC because I'm passionate about both art and social justice, especially after the rise in activism and engagement following the Black Lives Matter movement and tension in the political climate.
I decided to join the Arts Justice Council, or AJC, because I was given the opportunity to express my passions for arts education and social justice advocacy.
I decided to join the Arts Justice Council because I wanted to connect with people who love art and social justice as much as I do.
I joined the AJC after my poem on Black Lives Matter was published in our first edition of our student journal, The Road to Find.
One of the main projects that the AJC works on is The Road to Find, which is a journal with the goal to inspire youth to express their views and feelings on social justice through any artistic form.
An awesome opportunity that the AJC provides is that after you submit your work, and if your work is admitted into the journal, which is The Road to Find, you receive prizes and stuff like that, which you can actually use to fund your schoolwork, your creative projects, or anything you like.
Hi, my name is Amy Tian. I'm a senior from Irvine High School. For the first edition Road to Find Journal, which is created by Sonia, we talked about Black Lives Matter, and it was a very important and crucial issue at the time that needed to be discussed, and the journal was a great way for different artists to express their opinion, their thoughts on different issues, and it was great seeing how art, music, writing could speak so much volume in response to current events, and how we as a community can better serve others, especially the Black community during times of injustice. The second edition was about the election, and as you know, with a year with so much change and need for young voices to be heard, once again, this journal served as a great way for young people to get their voices heard and reiterate the importance of voting and registering to vote in this time of great change and great progress to be made, and really emphasize that we young people can make a great impact on the world around us. And the third edition, which is on its way of being produced, surrounding environmental justice, which I know is another crucial issue that we have to bring to the table. And I'm excited to see how that one will turn out, and I'm sure we'll get even greater and more abundant voices in that edition.
I highly recommend the AJC as a place to really find a sense of community, to bond with other like-minded artists, and to find a place where your voices and your curiosity about social justice and the world around you is heard and is valued by everyone.
So if you're into creative work, if you're into activism, if you just like to be a part of something that can truly make a difference, you should definitely consider joining the AJC.
I really highly encourage students to join. We have such a great sense of community in the AJC. It's really amazing to meet other student artists from all over the state, and be able to create art and be creative and do what we're passionate about while also working for social justice. And it's really an amazing experience, and I really highly encourage you to join.
Save the music, y'all. Save the music, y'all. Save the music, y'all. Save the music.
Great work, students. And now let's bring it back a bit. Just so inspired to hear the student voices and just be a part of or bear witness to the student leadership and just amazing, inspiring everything that they've done. Now let's just reground us and talk about what is Arts Justice. So we had an Arts Justice gathering in Southern California where Sophie, who's now a fellow with us, 2 years ago, she was an intern and a law student. So I want to invite Sophie back to share what is Arts Justice. And this picture, describe this picture that was taken just yesterday, right?
Yes, I would love to. So I'm just going to read out loud what we have on here. First, under the California Education Code, all students are guaranteed access to the arts. Despite this, millions of students in California are underserved when it comes to the arts, especially Black and Brown students. Studies show that access to the arts improves engagement in school, reduces dropout rates, supports mental wellness, promotes creative thinking and problem solving, and improves academic performance. The arts also unite communities, contribute to local economies, and foster civic engagement. Arts Justice is the fight to ensure that we all have access to the healing and opportunity that the arts provide. And what we really wanted to emphasize today is that it's so much bigger than just, you know, while we want equality and we want equity, we want to discuss the impact that arts truly has on the community. And so I took this picture yesterday at the ACLU Black Lives Matter rally outside of the ACLU office, which recently had this beautiful makeover. But I thought it was just a perfect example of bringing together, you know, Amir had drumming going on and we did stretching and just bringing together the arts and community and social justice and what that can really do for the community.
Thanks for that, Sophie. And you can see the mural says we need housing, education, healthcare, mental health support. Arts and culture is there as well. It's a little bit difficult to see because of the sunshine, but it's a really important and critical part of the work we do. And Arts Justice is a part of that. And it's not just about arts access or having arts in your school, but what do those arts look like, right? Are they culturally responsive and reflective of the students? I imagine you all may have seen the viral video of a teacher in Riverside down here dancing and chanting and doing different Native American expressions, right? But was that done in a just way? I think most people would say no. So we invite you all to share one word to describe art and drop it in the chat. Because when we started here in Southern California, we asked all of our participants and some of our attendees are here as well, but when we had our first Arts Justice gathering in SoCal, also with Create California, then known as the Alliance, we asked everyone in the room, which was over 100 people in our room in our office in Southern California, to describe what art means to them. So I encourage you all to describe it in one word, because when we asked this question before, people said words like art means soul, art means identity, joy, freedom, creativity, aesthetic, progress, engagement, activism. So these are some great words. Therapeutic. Does anyone want to share a word? Or Sonia, maybe you want to share a word about what art means to you?
Yeah, I wrote in the chat, I wrote togetherness. I really think over the past year, especially with me forming the AJC, with the journal, with meeting all of these incredible people, I've really seen how my love for art has allowed me to collaborate with other artists and make new connections and friendships and learn new things. And so for me, togetherness is the word that comes to mind.
Exactly. Art brought us together, right? So without that, I wouldn't have submitted one of your letters of recommendation last week for college, right? And also this picture here of you and Natalie performing together through music, the arts that brought you all together. But before we read this, what are some other things in the chat if another student wants to read? Or maybe Chanel, if you want to share a word about what art means to you.
Oh, I put creative thinking, but that's actually two words. So I'll just say creative.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Creativity. Right.
Amir, I'm happy to read through some of these in the chat. We got quite a few responses. We have meaning, expression, empowering, powerful, life, liberating, core, togetherness, unifying, humanity, platforms, freedom, creative thinking, connection, expression, community, accessibility. So some really wonderful responses.
Thank you all for sharing those responses. And just know that when we fight for art, well, I'm sure you all know, this is why you chose this career path. But I'm sure you all see the opposition we come against when people think, okay, art, you know, it's just gluing macaroni on a piece of paper, right? Or crayons and different things, which although that's a valid form of expression, art is soul and so much more. And the words you all shared, the work that you all do every day to give students a sense of expression and identity is a part of that. So that's why we fight for arts justice. Could we have another student read this quote here to the left by Jeff Goins? Maybe Natalie, could you read this quote?
Yeah, I would love to. Do you know why birds sing just before dawn? Scientists believe it's to tell their mates that they made it through the night as a way of saying, I'm still here. Maybe that's why we sing too, why we create art as a way of saying, I made it, I'm still here.
Yes, thanks for that, Natalie. So describe why you sing and what's happening in the picture to the right.
Yeah, so I had the opportunity to take an arts class when I was really young, and I have fell in love with art ever since. I've been singing for the majority of my life. I sing because not only has it given me such an incredible method of communication and allowed me to express emotions I wouldn't have otherwise been able to express through words, but it has given me such an amazing community. During the COVID-19 pandemic, something that has definitely kept me grounded and really helped with things like mental health and just staying grounded was my choir and the friends that I made through choir, my arts community. Sonia and Amir are people who I also met during the COVID-19 pandemic. And the picture on the right is actually the first time I got to meet Sonia in person. She came over here down to Los Angeles over the summer, and we had an opportunity to sing together. And that was actually the first time I sang in person in over a year and a half at that point. And it was so incredible to get to do it with Sonia. And it was just an amazing time to get to meet so many arts activists, so many incredible people, and also make some awesome music.
Awesome. Yes, and thank you, Sonia, for coming down for that. Another person who came to join us for that was Caitlin from Create California, who we're gonna pass it to next to share more about the great work they're doing and a really cool, important tool they have. And if you're really interested in those protests, because that's a Black Lives Matter protest that happens every Wednesday in front of our office at the ACLU of Southern California. But every third Wednesday, we're there with our students doing drumming. All right, Caitlin.
Thank you so much, Amir. I really enjoyed going to that event and meeting Natalie in person and seeing Sonia in person. We had worked together, but not actually got to hang out. So it was really wonderful being in that space and sharing that space with everybody. So as Amir mentioned, I'm Caitlin Lanoff. I'm the Youth Engagement Manager for Create California. And we're a statewide nonprofit which advocates for equitable arts education for California public school students. We were formerly, Amir mentioned briefly, the California Alliance for Arts Education, and this is our new name. So this year, Create California unveiled the first of its kind advocacy tool connecting the public to their local school board leaders. So this did not exist before. It was like you had to like search online for your specific contacts, email them individually. This tool quickly and easily sends messages directly to the school board members, adding your voice in support for the change that you want to see. You enter your address or zip code, and the tools pull up the school board emails as well as a customizable letter. You can select which school board members you'd like to send the message to or all, and the tool will take care of the rest. So this season, we're focusing on social emotional learning, something we can all benefit from, but especially students during this time of loss and upheaval. On Tuesday, the American Academy of Pediatrics declared the state of mental health for children and adolescents to be a national emergency. So we know that the arts can heal, and it is essential that all students have equitable access to the arts. There's a growing body of research proving that social and emotional learning is fundamental to not only academic success, but also students' mental well-being. The arts give students the tools to develop crucial social emotional skills, including resiliency, collaboration, empathy, and leadership. We've developed a flyer in both Spanish and English, which you can use to further support your advocacy with your school board members, your community, and familiarize yourself and others with the benefits that arts bring to social emotional learning and to students themselves. These are all downloadable online, and I can pop the links in after this. So we know that when students feel safe and supported in school, they can learn better. We all feel this way at work, in our communities, in our environments. And for those who have access, the arts can sometimes be the only space that students feel safe and seen in their day. It is crucial that all students have the opportunity to experience that. This is a big one. Districts are currently allocating $13.6 billion right now as part of COVID relief packages, determining what district priorities will be and shaping what the coming years will look like. So you have a right to say how that money will be spent. The tool allows you to quickly contact your school board members and encourage them to spend those funds by investing in arts education, which we know means investing in students' mental well-being, school engagement, and community growth. We hope you will join us in our fight for equity, where all students' needs are being seen and met. And to that end, if everybody wants to take a moment and check out the tool, I'm going to drop it in the link in the chat. My chat has disappeared. One second. Oops. I also want to give a shout out to our arts education activists in the chat. We have some students joining us, and Amir, we will touch base about this, but my dream is to bring our cohorts together so they can explode across the state, create some synergy and some magic in the future. So shout out to y'all, good to see you. And so the tool is in the chat. If you wanna go ahead and click on that link, it will pull up the tool automatically. You enter your zip or address into the tool, and you'll see that it should populate automatically your school board members. It also pulls up the letter of NOW. And Amira, you can let me know. We can read it or not. Y'all can read it at your own time, whatever is best for the time here. But I also just want to let y'all know that this letter is obviously time sensitive. It refers to ESSER funds, which will be decided shortly. So the goal of the tool is that it changes based on the urgency of the time. So, you know, we're always welcome to open to suggestions. If y'all have something happening that you think is statewide and would be applicable to all, please let us know. We really want to make sure that this tool stays current and active for advocates. So there's that, and I'll drop the flyer link, but otherwise I'm happy to pass on the proverbial mic here.
Thank you for that, Caitlin, and thank you all for creating that tool and lifting up that ESSER advocacy opportunity. Sophie's going to talk a little bit more about that later. And I'll share, I had another webinar just on Tuesday with folks all over Central Valley, and I shared your tool. Even though the webinar was not about arts education, they found it very helpful because districts kind of like to hide the contact information for people. So.
Yeah, it's really opaque. It's not easy. So we're so thankful that we were able to develop this and make it responsive. And the other thing I want to point out on the page is that it should tell you if there's an Arts Now community. So those are also groups of local advocates working in your area, so that you know that if you are interested in further advocacy or continuing your advocacy work, we can connect you with the people on the ground who are working in districts directly. So it's sort of all there.
Yes, it's critical to do this work in coalition, and the Arts Now communities are active all over the state. So thanks for that, Caitlin. And gee, I wonder why public officials or district officials would want to hide their contact info. Well, part of that relates to this. So I'll just share two more slides before passing it back to the students and why we talk about arts justice. This is something else that came from a report that the Alliance, or Now Create California, did. This was from their 2019 report, I believe, but it showed when it came to music, for example, Black students or African Americans here indicated by the blue bar all the way to the right, to the left, you see only 60% of schools that have majority African-American students have access to music in their school, compared to white students indicated by the yellow, which you can see it jumps to 93%. So 60% compared to 93%. And it's the same with visual art here indicated by art. 46% of Black students, students at majority Black schools compared to, you know, almost twice the rate, 93% with white students. And just an example, a student story we want to share, we like to uplift. And this is also the student you can see there on the mural that's on our office. And this story is the reason why we put her, part of the reason why. This is Alicia. She's a student, or she was a senior in schools in Los Angeles, in South Los Angeles last year. But she wanted to be an animator, visual designer. Ever since she was little, you know, loved cartoons, but she went to a high school that never offered any visual arts. And in her 11th grade year, she actually started a petition at her school to change that, and was the reason why our school now has some visual arts offering. But although she's now a freshman at USC, because of her lack of arts in her school, she was not able to create that portfolio and to apply to different art schools. So that is what we mean by arts justice, and that is the impact of arts justice, disadvantaging certain students and getting in the way of their dreams. And this slide, which we'll make available later in this presentation, shares more of her story from her perspective and some of her art. All right, passing it back to Sonia to keep talking, continue the conversation about the AJC.
Awesome. Thanks, Amir. So I think you guys saw that video, and that is kind of the attempts that me, Amir, Natalie, and a lot of people from the ACLU Arts Justice team have been trying to uplift is a student group of arts activists who are really excited to take this work and take these statistics and make some change. So these are our two cohorts. We started out pretty small, and then we expanded this year, and hopefully we're gonna keep growing and growing and spreading the word about what we do and our network. And so these are some of the things that we do. So we provide outlets for student creativity. That could be our journal, The Road to Find. We often promote or publicize other contests, arts contests. We amplify student voices, bringing awareness to the importance of arts funding and implementing arts-oriented legislation. So we really do touch the creative and the more kind of policy-oriented aspects of what kind of arts advocacy and arts justice means. Awesome. So this is The Road to Find. I'll just share a little bit about it. So I really found that over the pandemic, what was hard was a lot of the resources that students had, whether it be in class, outside of class, to do artwork was kind of taken away. I know I felt that. Like we were talking about earlier, I'm also a singer, and it was really hard for me to perform, to practice over the pandemic, because choral singing is kind of the last thing that anyone can ever do, coming back from COVID. You know, you're breathing on people, and that just doesn't work when you're in this kind of pandemic situation. So I was really feeling this need to express myself through art. And I think a lot of others around me were feeling the same way. And so in the midst of the pandemic, I met Amir, and we decided to form this online journal called The Road to Find. And it kind of amalgamates student creativity and student advocacy by allowing student artists to submit artwork of any form, so visual, performing, creative art, around various social justice issues. Our QR code is to the left if you want to scan and see some of the work we do, as well as the link that's above. And if we could go to the next slide, that would be amazing. So these are the additions we've had so far, and we'll get to our current one in a second, but we touch all sorts of issues. So the Black Lives Matter movement, the 2020 election, Our third edition came out in the spring about environmental advocacy, and the fourth was around health and mental health justice. And with each edition, we got to hear from student artists through poetry, through prose, through visual art, through even a black and white film, about how they were interfacing with these issues and what they meant to these students who were witnessing them. So this was our current edition. It was actually just published today, and it's called Pride is Still Protest, talking about the LGBTQIA advocacy movement and everything around that, and it was our summer fall edition. This beautiful cover art was done by Koo Lee, and Koo, if you would like to say a few words about making these pieces, being in the Road to Find, and what kind of arts justice means to you, I'd love to turn it over to you.
Yeah, I'd love to. So my name is Koo, and the reason why I decided to submit to this edition of The Road to Find is because, well, as a queer sort of teenager myself, I didn't really have any outlet to sort of express my like inner feelings about my relationship with queerness in like any sort of space that was nearby. So like in school or just to friends sometimes too, because even though they've been generally accepting, it's still hard to like bridge that gap because they're not like me. But once I found The Road to Find and this like specific theme that was about queerness, I was actually ecstatic because like it would connect me to people who I also knew. And I think if the piece itself really let me just unleash my rage onto the paper that was pent up for years. And I don't know, I just had a fun time doing it too. And personally for me, The Road to Find is just a great sort of convening point for like people of all backgrounds to sort of come together and just, I don't know, use art to express themselves. Like they can express their own meaning of art through The Road to Find, which is like just a journal for everybody to come together. And like it builds this nice little community that's kind of more accessible than if we were to all meet in person, because we're all over California. So I just really love that about the journal and AJC too.
Thank you so much, Koo, for sharing that and for sharing your art. Very cool room. And I like what you said about unleash the rage, because that is that we have these emotions that our response to what we see, outrage, many of us, right? I imagine your generation, especially just the past, you know, 6 or 7 years have been so hard for your generation. So I imagine you all need an outlet. So it's just an honor for us to support you all and provide that outlet and just be inspired by what you all share. So thank you.
I agree. I think it's so amazing that over the pandemic, there's just the space, because I know what's so hard about being a teenager and being online all the time, and going back to school even, is that there are so many feelings that we just don't know what to do with them. We don't know how to understand them. We don't know how to interpret them. And so having that space, having that outlet for art with a community that cares about what we're doing and listens and loves with, you know, with acceptance, unconditional acceptance, is a really good feeling to have. So thank you so much for sharing your story with us and for sharing your beautiful artwork with us. And please go and look at The Road to Find and see more of Koo's artwork on there. I will turn it over to Amir.
Mm-hmm. Sure. So another thing we engaged in was we had our school-based mental health as a civil rights contest. You know, and Sonia was just talking about young people experiencing all these emotions and feelings and not knowing how to respond. So we saw a lot of that. And Alicia, the student who led that petition at her school level, actually she was the winner of this contest, and that's her art to the left. Really talented student, and she did research. She asked students what they were experiencing or feeling as a research component to this art project. So it was actually a research project as well. And you see basically the young woman, young lady on the left, you know, talking about what she had in school compared to at right, what happened once distance learning happened because of the pandemic. But we sent this letter to the governor on behalf of students at over, 50 different schools. We had complete the surveys, and one of the findings was that, the need for mental health services or social emotional support has nearly doubled. So pre-pandemic, only 22% of students said they needed mental health support. Post-pandemic, which is indicated by red, another 32% said they could use mental health support. So over half of our young people could need or benefit from mental health support. Sonia and Natalie, one of you want to talk about another finding from that survey as well in relation to art?
Sure. Natalie, I'll turn it to you in one sec, but I think we found in this survey that music, dance, and media were really great ways of healing for students as kind of the adjustment to COVID happened, as everything happened. Natalie, do you want to say more on that?
Sure. I mean, it's really hard to quantify the effects that the arts can have on students because it's something that, has so many different impacts on different kids. And that's why I think having arts education that has so many different components, such as music, dance, art, or like visual art, is so important for everyone to have, and especially coming back from the pandemic in a time where a lot of kids felt really lonely and distanced.
Absolutely. And I'll just share today, I was just on a statewide meeting, and it showed that attendance or chronic absenteeism has increased by 30%. So a lot of students are not coming to school, and they share one of the reasons why is social anxiety, aside from, COVID and different things. So art can be one of the tools that help reintegrate students into the school environment. And we know art has a role in mental health. It creates empathy. And once someone is taught art, and these skills, we have them in for the rest of our life. I'm just gonna go through some of this a little fast just because of the time. But here's the letter that students submitted to the governor. And you can see in the demands, there was a demand for more arts and investments in this schools, and the letter was signed by over 30 organizations all across the state and by students from over 50 schools. So, and it was, written by students at our Youth Liberty Squad. So it was a student-led initiative. And as a result of the letter, well, actually here are the demands, and you can see the second one was to improve access to art. And it talked about the pandemic, but as a result of the letter, Sonia, you want to share, what are some of the things that happened in some of the meetings?
Sure. So as a result of the initial letter with the Youth Liberty Squad, we decided to draft a petition to support Counselors Not Cops and Arts Not Arrests. So really prioritizing mental health and arts investments into California school districts. We launched that petition in the fall of 2020, and we actually ended up getting over 4,000 signatures on that petition. So really incredible progress, and we got people from all over California to sign. And the petition went so well that we actually were able to meet with state officials. So we met with members of the California Senate, the California Assembly, and the State Board of Education. So this picture is me, another student, Amir, and some of the members of the State Board of Education all talking about some of the demands that were in our petition. So it was a really great way to bring students and the desires of students to a state level, I think in a way that I hope is repeated more often. And I think it's really great for students and adults to be interfacing, because students are the ones actually feeling the effects of legislation or of these policies that are coming out around education. And so having students in conversation with those people creates kind of more well-rounded, wholesome outcomes that really benefit the students that are present. So this post that is on the slideshow right now was me talking a little bit about the experience of drafting that petition, what happened, kind of the trajectory of it, and how incredible it really was to talk to those people. So the petition was a really great step, and I think it'll be an amazing process over the next few years to bring that really Bay Area specific, maybe really SoCal specific, somewhere in Central California also, and just statewide generally.
Yes, thank you for your leadership with that, Sonia. And another thing you did throughout this year was write an amazing op-ed, which we'll drop the link to that as well, but that was published in EdSource. So you also are our first student to be published in a news publication. But do you want to share a quote and share some of what you talked about there?
Yeah, sure. So this is the quote I had on here. The California Education Code requires complete visual and performing art, or VAPA, access, including instruction in music, dance, theater, and visual arts. However, nearly 9 out of 10 schools in California do not offer this instruction. Schools need to expand arts education to more students now more than ever. So the article kind of talks a little bit about how after the COVID pandemic, we really need to feel compassion. We really need to feel love. And we really just need some sort of emotional stability. And the arts have always been kind of an underserved, as Sophie had mentioned earlier. They've always been very underserved and lacking in places. And so it's really important that even after COVID, we really continue to uplift the arts, to spread arts to more schools and to more students, and really bring that to light. So that's kind of a bit about what the op-ed is. And I also kind of integrate more of my experience as a choral singer into the op-ed and talking about kind of what the pandemic was like for me and how I brought that back. So that's a little bit about the op-ed, and hopefully you guys will have the chance to read it.
Awesome. Thank you so much for that, Sophie. Sorry, Sonia. Sophie's our other great, amazing person. Both of you are arts justice and, you know, advocates. So, now, actually, we're just about halfway through, and we're going to transition to where I'm going to share our Arts Justice Bear report card, and we're going to hear from our panelists as well. But first, let's pay attention to our bodies and listen to our bodies, because I know I'm already starting to get a little, you know, stiff. Sonia or any other student, if you'd like to lead us through a stretch really quick, I think that would be really great. And I can start leading us through, and you can keep your camera off at this point if you want, but if you want to just push your hands out to the front of your camera, you see, stretching your hands. I like to put my hands low like this, wrist down, wrist up, wrist down, wrist up, get that carpal tunnel out, right? Stretch those fingers. Now we can see the solidarity because all of our hands look muscle manos the same, right? All right, someone else want to do another stretchy thing?
I think it might be nice to just stand up. I don't know about others. I'm going to keep my camera off, but some swinging around maybe.
Arms yeah. Back
and forth.
I agree. I'm going to stand up as well really quick. Taking a quick stand up. All right. This is, I always tell our students, this is a freedom space. You know, you're free to move. Listen to your body. We've been through an unnatural time, so it's really important to come back and listen to our bodies. Neck rolls. Yes. Cool. Let's do a neck roll. Let the weight of your head and or afro just move and shift slowly. And don't forget to breathe while we can. Yes, big fan of the neck rolls. Thank you for that, Koo. All right. Thank you to all of our students and young people for facilitating that part. And you'll still hear from students throughout this other portion as well. But we're just going to dive into some of more of the nitty gritty here. And I'll make this document available for everyone afterwards. But what you see here is our Arts Justice Bay Area report card. And this looks at California Department of Education, you know, at the state level, but also at the county level in the Bay Area. And I've split it into a few different slides so you can see. And again, we'll make the link available to everyone afterwards. But what we did here was focus on 5 counties in comparison to the state. So today we're joined by people from all over, from Alameda County, Santa Clara County, San Francisco County, and other places. And you all across the state, which this map to the top left indicates, and the map is from a tool from Create California, from their arts data project, Bob Morrison and his research. But what that map shows is, across the California, even Northern California in the Bay Area, you see wide variation among the percentage of students who are enrolled in art. So you see the reddish brown areas indicate that, below average, as low as 27% of students are enrolled in art. But in some counties, it's over 57%. So for that variable, just art enrollment, the percentage of students in a school that are enrolled in an art class in a given school year. At the bottom, that's indicated in yellow. So for example, in Alameda County, they have a slightly above average arts enrollment to the state, because statewide only 40% of students are enrolled in art. In Alameda County, it's 42%. In Marin County, it's 55%. We know Marin is one of the richer counties. In San Francisco, it's 44% as well. So that's 10% higher than the state average, but still not as high as other counties or as high as we aspire to be. And Santa Clara County is also at that number, 44%, so 10% higher than the state. Unfortunately, in Santa Cruz County, it's over 10% lower than the state at 35%. And again, this is just at the county level, but if we look at it within schools or districts within the county, we'll see those inequalities even more. Another variable we looked at across these counties is percentage of schools with no art, and that's indicated by red here. And in Alameda County, about 5% of schools have no art. And in Santa Cruz County, over 11% of schools have no art, unfortunately. And again, if you look in districts, you can see in some districts, it's an even higher number. Another important factor here is the percentage of schools with all 4 arts. And we know under the California Education Code, as Sonia mentioned in her op-ed, students are entitled to, the core arts. But only in Alameda County, only about 7% of schools have all 4 arts. In San Francisco, it's significantly higher. It's at 21% of schools have all 4 arts. So we would love to hear from Sam about some of the things influencing that. But I imagine even Sam wants to see that number higher, right? But you can talk about some of the barriers to that and what he's doing to address that. And you can see in Santa Clara County, it's about 11% of schools have all 4 arts. So that's roughly around the state average. And we see in Santa Cruz County, it's half the state average there as well at 6%. So these are some of the numbers we have here. And we also just have some of the big picture stuff that, Latinx students are 30% of schools, are the majority of 30% of schools in the Bay, but are the majority at 54% of schools with no art. And it's the same with Black students. They're only 43% of majority Black schools in the Bay Area have access to music, compared to 95% of white schools. So when we look at this across discipline, we see the same sort of variations across the county. So here we have the 4 arts discipline and then other art all the way to the right, which often includes media art. And what this does is each county is represented by a color. So in Alameda County, which is represented by the brownish red color, about at least 21% of students are enrolled in visual art, and 18% in music, et cetera. And it goes down the line, and when it comes to Marin County, it's about 29%. So you see variations across all counties. But really, when it comes to dance and theater, you see that all counties could do better, could offer more opportunities to the students. And then last but not least, I want to share what art looks like across the region of the Bay Area, across, you know, six different settings, because we know students who are incarcerated or in alternative school settings often don't have the same access to art, and that's what this represents. So this first graphic to the top left that says high schools, you see a lot of blue there because each blue dot indicates that the school or district has above average, above state average arts access, so 40% or above. A red dot indicates it's below average. So for example, when it comes to juvenile court schools all the way on the right, right, you see it's almost all of them are significantly below average, and oftentimes they have no credentialed art teacher in there. Although we understand there are other ways to deliver arts outside of credentialed art teachers. And it's the same for special education schools, for Black schools that have 20% or more Black students, you see a lot of red dots there as well. And for alternative and continuation schools, and I myself, as someone who got into a lot of trouble as a young person, you know, use the arts to stay out of trouble. So we really need to make sure we reach these vulnerable students even more so. And also just sharing that the report card, which I'll share the link to as well, it has a part that says action and resources that provides links to different things that can be done, some of which we talked about today as well. All right, so that's our Arts Justice report card, which again, I'll make available later. Now we wanna invite our panelists to rejoin. And we want to give them the freedom to, they can share a presentation, respond to some of what they heard the students share, respond to some of what was seen in the Arts Justice report card as well, but just giving them the freedom to share, you know, what they are seeing as arts educators. And also want to ask our panelists to introduce yourselves, reintroduce yourselves, and share more about your background and your introduction to art maybe as well. So if we could start with Sophia Fojas in the Santa Clara office, the County Office of Education. And Sophia's in the county office setting. She's the only person in the county office setting, which often serves some of the students in those alternative settings. So it's a really critical, important job that she does, serving some of our most neediest students. Sophia?
Thanks. Thanks, Amir. So I just wanted to say that actually Sam is technically at a county office as well. He just serves a dual purpose, but does direct service to students. Look at that smile. I am at a true county office in that I am in a support position really for 32 districts. And I count the county offices as a district as well. We have oversight over the alternative education schools and the court and community schools as well. So let me just share a screen so that you can get some idea of what it is that I do. Can everyone see my slide deck? Okay. So Artspiration actually sits a little separately from the regular county office professional learning. It is actually part of the advocacy piece. And we are the Arts Education Initiative of the Santa Clara County Office of Education. Its foundation was actually in folding in cultural initiatives of Silicon Valley in the 90s. And they became sort of the arts piece for the county office. In our most recent strategic plan, I actually inherited this and have really, you know, the bolded pieces, the partnering piece, the equitable and transformative education, those elements of the vision are really, really near and dear to me and really guide me in my work. And as well as the shared leadership piece, I do convene an arts education leadership council, but I don't rule over them. We actually convene as equals and sit and talk about arts education, and it is teachers, administrators, and arts organizations. And it really is about a sustainable arts education. So interestingly, even though I am a single subject music teacher and a violinist and violist pre-pandemic, I have played since the pandemic, but my focus has really been on elementary arts and how can we make elementary arts and arts education from the foundation, which is elementary school, up. That's been a real focus for me. This is my team. You might for those of you in San Francisco and Alameda, Amy Espiritu also works in this county as my arts equity specialist. And then I have Katy Silva, who's actually the Spanish bilingual arts and integration specialist, and she brings some restorative circle practice as well. So we, the team and I actually got together, and I really defined areas of focus. We are an advocacy, a part of the Santa Clara County Office of Education. And so our work is in three buckets: teaching and learning, and we have two communities of practice. We have coming up the Marion Silker Conference for Arts and Education, again, stressing the need to do integrated arts at the elementary level, because we know that all of us need to teach the arts, not just arts specialists. Arts specialists, teaching artists and arts organizations, and general education teachers. The communication piece, I do have a young artist showcase that takes place in March around Arts in Education Month. And then we have, revised our website. We have eBlast, we have social media. I'm part of the state level SESESA arts committee. And then Hewlett Foundation does fund this initiative. So we're very lucky and very appreciative of that. And then the advocacy piece, I mentioned the Leadership Council. I'm Holland's Heroes, SESESA again, the Creek California Policy Council, just arts equity work in general. And then I also serve on the board of the National Guild for Community Arts, because I think that as I was listening to your presentation around the arts, we are all so arrogant about thinking that the arts only exist in schools. The arts are part of life. And we really, in order to get a sense of what's really happening for youth, what's happening everywhere in the community and in the schools. So this is part of our fall work. Again, the Marion Silker Conference, I'm knee deep in that. It is virtual, but no less rigorous. And really arts and culture organizations coming together to really center the experiences of our families of color, because we know that a majority of students in the public schools are students of color. And in Santa Clara County, the majority of students also speak another language other than English. And then we have our communities of practice that convene around arts. Again, my focus is arts is life. It is healing, it is community, it is engagement for students and families. And how can we broaden the concept of arts, not just as a sort of a conservatory model for arts, but a community model for arts. And here's how you can stay connected. Here's my new logo and our social media and also our website. So I'm going to stop share.
Thank you for that, Sophia.
Yeah.
And thank you for those reminders that, yeah, we get a bit arrogant and, well, we get passionate to say that, you know, pretend that art exists in a vacuum in schools. Community arts provide a critical, amazing part of the work we do. And I think our next speaker can speak more about that. Miko Lee, who's with the Teaching Artist Guild. But before I bring Miko on, something else you said, Sophia, about the focus on elementary education. California is so bad, we don't even measure arts access at the elementary level, right? And it's interesting how fast we forget that the first thing you learn in school, right, your ABCs, is art. It's a song. It's using pitch, rhythm, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and the magic of music to get into memory of youth. It's the first thing. And then we forget about that and take music out of the schools. So thank you for that, Sophia. All right. So our next panelist, and if you have questions or comments or thoughts, we encourage you to write them as well in the chat. But our next panelist, also in the area, she's done work all across the Bay Area as well. I believe she worked in Marin as well, so she could tell us about what they're doing in Marin, what's in the sauce, aside from a lot of dollar signs up there. But Miko Lee, if you could introduce yourself and share your work.
So I am Miko Lee, go by she, her. I'm on Ohlone territory, and I have worked in almost every district in the Bay Area, I do believe. Although I come to this today with multiple hats on, one as one of the leaders of Teaching Artists Guild, which is about supporting and uplifting teaching artists, because as you could see, we just do not have enough art specialists. There are not enough art specialists to even fulfill the law. We need teaching artists, and teaching artists that have that connection with community, that know about relationships, that are deep, that are connected to culture, connected to home culture, connected to a sense of belonging and a sense of place. So I'm also here with another hat on as a consultant for SRI and the update of the unfinished canvas, which many of you know is a research report that was done over, I think, 12 years ago now. And there has been a re-looking at what happened with the unfinished canvas to say, wow, what happened in the 12 years since then? Of course, a global pandemic really shook things up in that landscape. So the report is not officially released yet because it's still awaiting data. I think, Amir, just like your report, officially the data from the California Department of Education to truly finish it. But preliminary data from that basically echoes everything that Amir's report card just showed. The difference with this update of the unfinished canvas, which I was actually just on a conversation with Derek Fenner yesterday, and we were saying we should rename it Still Unfinished Canvas, because actually over 12 years, we've seen that little has actually changed. Yes, there's a few more art teachers that are hired. Yes, there's a few more arts places that have facilities, but overall, still an unfinished canvas. The difference this time is that because Hewlett Foundation was really looking at the impact of equity across all of their programs, there was a special focus study that was very much looking at systems involved youth. And this is the first arts education study that's really looking at young folks that are impacted by the system. And by that, we mean multiple aspects, not just, yes, the court and community schools, but also the incarceration facilities. And we all know that that is shifting wildly within our landscape in the state of California right now. As our state is closing down the youth authorities and shifting the camps and shifting the juvenile detention, there's still this huge gap of the language that they're using, which is really great language. I just want to say they're using good language around transformational justice and how arts and, you know, social emotional learning and arts learning is so critical. And we want to see a little pedal to the metal with what they're talking about, because yes, that's true. Yes, we love it. And then what's going to happen? Because what this study has shown is that, yes, we thought kids in typical schools, you know, even the schools in Marin, the most privileged area that we're talking about, even those students are not getting all the access. And if you drill down on those numbers, you know, and I know from working in all the Title I schools in Marin, the students in the Black and Brown communities are not getting the arts anywhere near what the schools, the public school students that in Marin's case, many of those public schools are like private schools because they're funded so much by the PTA system that exists. We know in most Title I schools, there aren't even PTAs to be able to provide additional funding for the arts. And so the CCS study that is coming out is really looking at those differences. And what we find is that they're vast. Of course, they're vast. Most schools in those situations do not receive any arts at all. The leaders at those sites, and it varies because the sites are so different. So we're talking about probation, we're talking about superintendents in a county office, we're talking about county superintendents. So they're very different situations these students are in. Most of them do not receive any arts at all. And when they do, they are from a nonprofit that, you know, is great, that comes in, that's skilled, that's got all the chops to come in and deliver those services. And oftentimes they're the ones that are butting the heads against the system to just even get in the door, even when they've got the funding to be able to provide programs for those students. So recommendations are being worked at with that study right now. And I just want to also point out that in this last week, a study by the American Academy of Arts and Sciences was just released. That's a national study. And let me see, I'm going to throw into the chat a link to that, because that also echoes every darn thing. Oops, let me find it. I'll find it for you in a moment. That echoes everything that we're talking about too. That study is basically saying, you know, if you're in a wealthy school district, you're getting some arts, but really almost nobody is getting all, you know, now in California, 5 art forms, right? Nobody's getting all 4. And so that study in particular is really looking at telling case studies of folks that have been impacted by the arts, laying it all out there and saying how we are at a time in our culture that is a time for change. So the one last thing I want to say, because I don't want to take over my time and I would love to take questions, is that part of that time, part of that change that we want to offer at Teaching Artists Guild is that we feel like teaching artists are the ones that can make the difference in providing those opportunities for our young people to connect to who they are and how they fit into their community and what future they can create for themselves. And we are in December 7th through 9th hosting with the National Endowment for the Arts, the Federal Department of Education, Arts Education Partnership, and the Hewlett Foundation, the first national teaching artist convening that's looking at systems change. And it is called Our Shared Future, Imagining a New Landscape for Teaching Artists. And we invite you all, especially you young, beautiful minds with all of your brilliant ideas, to join that conversation, because then we can make that change together to create a new system that is brighter for all of us. So I'll throw those links in after. Thank you.
Thanks for that, Miko. And yes, thank you for keeping it 100 with us and saying a still unfinished canvas. But it's great to hear that, you know, youth and juvenile justice settings are not forgotten about at this time when we're thinking about the canvas. That shows progress, because previously, you know, we weren't thinking about those youth. And it's so disheartening to hear that youth with the most creative energy, because that's why some of them got there in the first place, have the least creative outlets, you know. Down here in Southern California, I'm a board member and previous board chair of the Arts for Healing and Justice, previously called the Arts for Incarcerated Youth Network. And we have almost 40 teaching artists in 12 facilities all over LA County. And they're often the only ones teaching art and pushing the envelope, like Miko said, but they also face barriers with, you know, you can only have pencils without erasers because they're weapons. You can't have a paper with a staple in it because that's a weapon, or different things. So thank you for that, Miko. All right, so our last panelist comes to us also with a wealth of knowledge. And again, my apologies for mistaking earlier, but San Francisco Unified District, or San Fran Unified, is also, you know, kind of, it's a county of its own. I think Santa Clara and other, what they call, you know, LEAs, county offices, just have multiple districts there, right? But now we'd love to hear from Sam Bass with San Francisco Arts. And about the uniqueness of that district and just some of the great things he's doing there.
Wonderful, thank you. Yes, we are a very unique district. If you keep up with the politics, you know that. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm very, very excited to be here. This is my third year in this role. I am a former high school principal and a former elementary principal, as well as a former music teacher. This year in our arts department, we're continuing to focus on increasing the potential for arts and creativity for our most marginalized students, and our focus on anti-racist arts instruction in all of our classrooms pre-K-12. In August, we presented a new draft of the Arts Education Master Plan to the Curriculum Committee of the Board of Education. It is now called Arts and Creativity 2025, SFUSD's Arts Equity Plan. Not only does it include the work from the task force for several years that has been putting it together and updating our plan that some of you actually on this Zoom were a part of, it also includes initiatives and language from the board adopted arts equity resolution from 2019. And all of these documents are available to the public on board docs of the San Francisco Board of Education. Please feel free to shoot me an email if you want. I can send them to you. And here actually is my email address in case you want it. We are currently, for those of you who aren't as familiar with how funding works in San Francisco Unified, we are currently funded solely through the voter approved Public Education Enrichment Fund, also known as PEEF, P-E-E-F. PEEF was approved by the voters of San Francisco in 2004 to enhance, that's a key word, enhance art, music, libraries, and sports. It has since morphed into a much larger bureaucratic funding stream that we are now, as I said, solely funded from. So that's not the definition of enhancement if you're solely funded from it. Over the past 3 years, the Public Education Enrichment Fund has steadily decreased, largely in part to the pandemic and its effects on city revenue through tourism and other revenue sources. Just recently in June of 2020, we had to reduce the arts budget by $1.2 million due to city revenue loss. The board directed the district staff to ensure that school sites didn't feel the effect of that revenue loss. So we were only allowed to reduce programs that didn't directly touch sites. This meant we had to pause what was known as the Mosaic Initiative that was tied to the 135 Arts Project, which is a project intended to turn the address, the city block of 135 Van Ness Avenue into an arts center, an arts hub, and to move the Ruth Asawa School of the Arts magnet to that property as well, to be included in the San Francisco Arts Corridor along Van Ness and Franklin. Along with the pandemic, you may know or have seen in the press that SFUSD is currently facing a multi-year, multi-million dollar budget deficit, which means there are reductions and cuts district-wide. Needless to say, the 135 Arts Project, as presented to the board last week, has been stopped, and much of those funds are being repurposed to fund needs of existing buildings and other projects that have more urgent needs than an arts center. And I can talk a little bit more about that in just a second. But for those of you not familiar with the structure of arts education in our district, it's important to know that we do not currently fund full-time music teachers, art teachers, dance teachers, theater teachers at school sites, meaning no elementary site has a full-time music teacher or any other discipline unless the school site raises money to pay for that position. Our department can only provide part-time arts instruction at each elementary site, which I know is kind of a California norm, unfortunately. And this includes the elementary instrumental pullout program for fourth and fifth grade. We have a strong partnership with the Mr. Holland's Opus Foundation, just like the Santa Clara County Office of Ed does, Sophia does. They recently completed a comprehensive audit of our entire music program, and they found that our elementary instrumental pullout program is extremely problematic in the access that it denies to music education to our students with other learning needs, such as IEP support, English language support, behavioral or social emotional support, or other factors that would keep them from being allowed to miss another academic class to attend music. In fact, as the audit shows, and that's available, that's public also, I could send it to you. It is possible for an SFUSD student, if you have an IEP or need ELL support, you could get through your entire SFUSD experience with no arts education. That is possible in San Francisco.
I'm sorry, can you just restate that?
It is possible if you have academic learning needs that trump your arts education experience, that you not get it. You are unable to be pulled out for an elementary instrumental program and your school doesn't have a music teacher, you don't get it in elementary. So then you get to middle school, and if your school only has a 6-period day and your elective has to be your ELL support, then you don't get your elective. Then you get to high school and you need to get that A to G requirement F credit.
Right.
And you haven't had arts instruction your entire SFUSD educational career. It's something to talk about. And that's what we're pushing for now. So
I just want to point out, Sam, that's like 30% of the population, roughly, if, you know, anywhere from 10 to 12% of students, actually up to 15% of students can, you know, students with disabilities, with IEPs. And then we know in California, at least 20% of students are English learners. So that's a large chunk of students.
Yeah, and not all of those students are denied our access to arts education, but
they're in a universe that doesn't protect them to ensure they have.
Well, yeah, the fact that even one can't access it means we have a ton of work to do, right? So that's why we've made it our top priority and our top focus to push for more funding for an increase in arts funding to provide more arts teachers across the district. Our students have a right to an appropriate comprehensive arts education experience that is standards-based and performance-based. And until we convince the city of San Francisco that this is critical to the success of our students, we will continue to see our highest risk students fall through the cracks. It's heartbreaking, really, especially, you know, as an arts educator myself, lifelong musician. I started piano when I was four, and it's why I got into education in the first place. And, you know, I've taught in other areas of the country in other school districts, and I still 11 years into SFUSD, I do not understand why the norm is part-time arts instruction. Like, who decided which standards we were going to teach and which ones we weren't? Which subject areas and which content areas we were going to make sure exist, and then the other ones are just secondary, and if we can get to them, if we can fit them into the schedule. And it's really a problem of funding. And it's a problem of that manifests itself through scheduling at school sites. As a former principal, I can tell you, it was not my decision to not offer as much arts as we could. I had little control over what I could offer based on the funding that was provided to me through district priorities and initiatives and the budgeting process. So you know, I'm saying that just as a plug for principals. It's not always the site administrators who are lacking the heart and the drive for increasing arts access, but it's more systemic than that. And until we get the funding in place to solve the scheduling issues, we're going to keep running through this problem. And yes, Suze, I see you on here. And that's why I said, when you asked for my one word about what the arts mean to me, it's core. And it should be funded as core. And until we do, we're going to have this injustice.
Wow. The end. Yeah, mic drop. Mic, just light it on fire, Sam. It's just, wow. I mean, San Francisco, when we hear San Francisco, we think of, I'm actually coming up to the Bay Area this weekend, and I can't wait to go to the San Francisco, you know, the Mission District, see the walls with murals and just different things. And it's an art center for the world. And a student can go through there. You know, I think Carlos Santana's, you know, he was in that district, right? They had that huge mural of him, one of the most influential musicians in the world. And people study him all over the world, but a student might not even be able to study him or guitar, you know, in their career, in his home area. So thank you all. Thank you to all of our panelists, and for all of our students as well who shared this incredible, tremendous info. Thank you to everyone in the chat as well, sharing really important points, dropping important links as well. And I agree. That the PEEF funds should not, what Francis said, you know, should not be the sole source of support for this San Francisco Unified. In our report card, actually, we have links about how your LCFF funds can support that. And, you know, just ESSER funds, just different pockets of money should be used to support the arts. Because as Sam mentioned, it's an issue with money at the end of the day, oftentimes, right? And that's often the reason why. Do folks have any questions for our panelists or for our students, or do we have any questions for each other as panelists? I have a question if no one else has one, but I want to offer up that space to anyone else who might have a question. All right, so I see Sue's raised their hand.
Yeah, I was just curious how students can participate in the organization and also in the group that's putting together those news, or not newsletter, it's, sorry.
They like to call it a digital journal because it has
digital journal. Sorry, my brain is mushed today. But yeah, I'm just wondering if it's open for students like all over and how they apply.
Yeah, Sonia.
Yeah, so The Road to Find is open to any student ages 11 to 18. We're actually opening up our next call for submissions. Edition 6 is on women's rights. So you can send that link to access any of our digital journals or send a call to submissions for any students that want to take part. You can also follow our social media links. Let me put those in the chat. This is for our Arts Justice Council. We always post updates on our journal and if we are opening up the council for the year, and the Youth Liberty Squad, which is kind of a larger extension of the education policy work that happens with the ACLU SoCal. So those are some ways to get involved, and I hope that you know, meeting today can help spread the word on all of that.
Was muted. Thank you for that question, Suze. And on the screen now, I have the advertisement for the next art journal that the students are doing. Thank you, Natalie, for making this flyer. And thank you all the students for coming up with this. I love how they prioritize whatever the times is reflecting. So we know women's rights and women's bodies are under attack all over the country. And our students chose that to uplift and prioritize. So thank you for that. So speaking of that, so Sophie, you want to talk, if you're available, to talk a minute or two more about what Caitlin actually mentioned earlier with the ESSER funds, just of ways that we can engage and support funding requests at the district level.
Yes, I would love to. I see one question.
Oh yeah, sorry about that. First. What's that other question?
I see a raised hand.
I had a question for Sam that Sophia may also want to ask it, but it seems that part of the beauty of this particular group is to invite students into the advocacy space on behalf of arts education. And is there a moment coming when young people speaking up at a school board meeting in San Francisco, what would the appropriate timing and particular message would support what you need?
The timing, well, thinking practically, the timing would be when budget season hits, right? Especially this February when budget season starts, and there's also some voting that San Francisco voters are going to have to do around our board members. That would be a time to do it. And then, what they would be advocating for, the voice that they could have, is really telling their story of their arts education journey. You know, we just started having high school interns working in our arts department now for the first time this year, and last year. And their voice has been incredible. Students, I can't thank you enough for being part of this, because your voices are the work. Your voices are the ground that we are working from. And so the board members hearing anything about a student's journey in San Francisco, of what they got and what they didn't get, what they wish they had gotten, what they should have gotten, what they had a right to get, could be really powerful.
Thanks for that, Sam. And actually a follow-up to that, because you mentioned the city as a potential area of advocacy, and I know some of the funding, is there ways that, things that we can raise at the city level, at the city council meetings or different things as well?
Well, you know, when you're running your house and you're filing for bankruptcy, it's real easy to tell all the kids no to everything because you're filing for bankruptcy. kind of where we are as a district. When you're facing the large budget deficit that we're facing, any advocacy sometimes can fall on deaf ears because there's just nothing there. And so it's really more at a city level, like you just said, with more help from San Francisco city supervisors and from the mayor, not to say that they're not supportive of our work at all, because they are, but it's really looking at that funding, because our district right now is in, we're in years of a really dark cloud over us, and it's going to be everything I can do just to maintain our programming that we currently have, much less increase anything, unless we're considered core and unless other funding streams are identified to put PEEF back in its place.
Right, we have to hold the line at very minimum, right? Just at least don't take what we already have, because it wasn't enough yesterday, right? So it won't be enough for tomorrow if you take more of it, right? So, and with that, passing it back to Sophie to talk about this ESSER Opportunity Fund and the tight turnaround that we're facing with this. Because this, by the way, as Caitlin mentioned, using their tool with Create California, you can send a message to your district officials.
Yeah, so that was a perfect segue into talking about how we can maybe get some more funding for the arts. And so this is just, I summarized, even broke down even more Create CA's one, or it's a few pages on the American Rescue Plan Act, but I put the link in the chat and it's really wonderful. But just to break it down really quickly, essentially we have this huge opportunity right now for funding, and some of that money can be used for arts education. So the American Rescue Plan funds for arts education. So ESSER is Elementary and Secondary School Emergency Relief Funds. Local education agencies must engage in meaningful consultation with community members when developing the expenditure plan. So the plans must be adopted very soon, on or before October 29th, 2021. And that's why we really wanted to put this in here, to push people in the community to meet with your districts, either your federal programs manager or the person in charge of building your school district's ESSER funding request. And I had, so the document that I put in the link has some other helpful resources in terms of doing that. But just also know that the plans are considered living documents, and the local education agencies will be able to update them and revise them based on need. So we just really wanted to put a plug in to advocate. Props to Create CA for creating this awesome document. And yeah, let me know, or let us know if you have any questions.
Thanks for that, Sophie. And that's important. Budgets are living documents. So it's, even if, well, get in some comments before October 29th next week, right? But even after that, we can still change it. Budgets are also moral documents. They reflect what we value. So for example, we know districts, some districts spend more money on police than arts, and that's a moral failure. Well, we talked a lot about Road to Find, but any final comments someone from Road to Find or Arts AJC want to share about the Road to Find?
No, I think we got to all of it. Natalie, if you wanted to say anything.
Yeah, so Natalie, actually, she's working on a resolution down here in LA that came from her leadership and her initiative. And then we found out that there was a resolution to prioritize art passed in San Fran Unified as well. And Natalie, you want to talk more about your work there?
Yeah, definitely. And Amir, would it be possible to move to the next slide? I put some points. Thank you so much. So hearing Mr. Bass's, you know, explanation of the situation in SFUSD brought up a lot of similarities to what I experienced in the LESD school district. A lot of my friends did not have an opportunity to take band because that was the only arts class offered at my middle school, to be able to take another elective that would be able to continue throughout high school and that they knew or they thought was more valuable than arts education. Elementary school, a lot of parents had to pay out of pocket to be able to afford an arts teacher. And so some of the things that this LESD resolution is trying to achieve is outlining steps to increase arts enrollment for the 600,000 students in LASD by 2025, close disparities in arts program funding between different marginalized groups, support student mental health, and implement anti-racist arts curriculum to reflect students' cultural diversity. And so some of the points that I have, that we have on the slide here, got inspiration from the SFUSD Rights of All Students to Arts Learning. And so this resolution is aspirational to some of the initiatives. So first, we want to ensure that the LASD Board of Education is committed to closing the current disparities in arts program funding between different racial, ethnic, and economic backgrounds by providing them with necessary resources, including qualified administrators. And this includes not just part-time teachers, but full-time employee teachers, teaching artists, and other staff, adequate materials, teachers will not have to pay out of pocket to afford their students arts materials, and appropriate facilities at no extra cost for students, such that no student should be expected to pay rent for instruments or purchase materials to fully participate in VAPA programs. And this includes, you know, across a wide variety of art forms, whether it's buying uniforms for dance, reeds for your clarinet and band, other like outfit materials for choir, et cetera. Something that we also took inspiration from the Rezo is to support the implementation of arts programs reflecting and promoting students' cultural diversity and developing music instruction that reflects the city's rich cultural diversity and heritage. And in addition to that, something that the Rezo states is that they evaluate music programs every 3 years. And we kind of saw a parallel to this in Los Angeles with the Arts Equity Index. And that's something we hope to, I guess, resurface and reimagine statistics in 2021. We want to make sure that there's monitoring of these arts programs post-pandemic and seeing how situations either improved, worsened, or remained the same, and creating an existing framework and building on existing frameworks to make sure that we have appropriate data to kind of continue on in the future with building these art programs. And so these are just some key points. And there's a lot of work to be done throughout all of California. And I think we can each take inspiration from one another in creating future initiatives, whether it's Los Angeles, the Bay Area, or other places in California.
Awesome. Thank you for that, Natalie. And also just sharing the social media from the Arts AJC. We wanted to share that as an example of how the work happening in San Francisco is influencing and inspiring the work down here in SoCal. And likewise, the work down here in SoCal is also influencing the work up there. So it's a family. And let's give one more big round of applause for all of our students and panelists today. And thank everyone for joining us today to share space and be in community with us. I just dropped the link to the presentation that I shared earlier, but we're going to send some links out to everyone who registered along with the recording, because I know some people weren't able to join live. So thank you all for joining with us and have a great weekend. I want to pass it to one of our students for the last word. Chanel, pass it to you, Chanel, for the last word. Say goodbye to everyone.
Thank you everyone for joining. I think that's about it.
Cool. Thank you. All right. Bye, y'all.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you.